And toward the end, perhaps they still would like my fantasy. How quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if creatures from another planet should threaten this world. Very interesting stuff. He actually spoke to Mikhail Gorbachev at one time, too, about this stuff. In 1985, at the first summit meeting between Reagan and Gorbachev, Reagan surprised the Soviet premier with his odd line of questioning. He said, "From the fireside house, President Reagan suddenly said to me, 'What would you do if the United States were suddenly attacked by someone from outer space? Would you help us?' And Gorbachev said, 'No doubt about it.' And then Reagan said, 'We too.'" So that's interesting. Gorbachev said, to much laughter, of course. Reagan was always on the forefront of that stuff. I want to play a little track here, and then I want to read a quick segment from Nick Redfern's The NASA Conspiracies, and then we'll rock back into the show with the Clary Croft interview on Unified Field.
Don't touch that dial. An alternate reality awaits.
Just a couple more things to talk about here on the Unified Field before we go into the Clary Croft interview. We're kind of pushing it a bit. I really want to read the story from Nick Redfern's The NASA Conspiracies. It's just a quick couple pages from the book that I thought was really cool, and I think you guys are going to like it too. The story is basically about... this one here. This comes from allnewsweb.com again, and it's about a UFO landing photographed in Argentina, And if you want to see the picture, go to allnewsweb.com and do a search for UFO landing in Argentina, and this story will come up. It's written by Michael Cohen, and it came out on 13th of February, so that's today. And it says here, the UFO photograph seen above comes from the city of Posadas in the province of Misiones, Argentina. And it was taken around 4 months ago, however, has only been made public recently. The UFO was seen and photographed by Luis, I'm not even going to attempt to pronounce this guy's last name, but maybe I'll give it a shot. Let me see. Pierzyansnik, a well-respected leader of Argentina's Polish community, Mr. P., has affirmed that the sighting was genuine and sent the image to the local astronomical laboratory for analysis. Professor Sergio Toscano, head of the Padre Colping Astronomical Laboratory, noted that the UFO must have been rather large due to its size in relation to a cow in the foreground. Professor Toscano also noted that the light from the craft was reflected on the ground and the object must have been suspended a few meters above the field. So go to All News Web and check that out. It kind of looks like from way over on the other end of the field there's a giant mirror and someone's like positioned it to directly reflect the sun. Maybe it's got some kind of blue coating over the mirror to give it some kind of light. But who knows? I mean, it kind of looks like some of the UFO photographs taken in the past. And this is actually a question I have about you guys. So is there a UFO conference that still takes place in Lima, Peru? Because I think in 2004, they had a International Congress of UFOs. I think that's what they called it. And I haven't heard anything about it since. I just think it would be interesting because my girlfriend and her dad, and I'd love to be invited if I... Well, I am invited, but I got to get my stuff together. I'd love to go. Talking about going to Machu Picchu in April of this year. So that would be cool. But yeah, it's so close, right? I mean, that's in Peru, basically. So it'd be cool if there was a conference going on and, you know, Serendipity at the same time. Wouldn't that be something else? But yeah, it'd be cool to find out. I don't know if it's, like, defunct now or not. There was another UFO sighting actually seen in Peru I want to mention quickly. And it's been seen by multiple witnesses. There's a video, a YouTube video, over Peru. If you go to allnewsweb.com, again, posted February 9th. It says here, the UFO event seen below and reported on a Peruvian television news crew occurred about a month ago in early January. The sighting took place in Lima, Peru's capital city. The elongated UFO, covered in bright lights, was seen by numerous residents and filmed by at least two witnesses from more than one angle, making the sighting of immense interest to UFO enthusiasts and researchers alike. And I got to tell you, I saw this video and it is really great. It looks legitimate to me. It's, you know, a little family from Peru and they've taken it on a camera and zoomed in on it and it looks authentic. There's some, the lights almost look like they're sparkling off this really flat, it looks like an immense disc, like a big plate way off in the distance. And it looks huge to me. Like I wouldn't even be able to judge a distance, but I mean, it could be a mile long, you know, a big plate a mile long. Who knows? Very cool stuff. There was a little clip here. Do I still have the clip? Okay, I'm just going to play about 30 seconds of this clip, and then I'll tell you what's going on here. It's pretty weird, but interesting.
Okay, Noelle, let me do a quick exam, okay?
Okay.
Okay, Noelle, you're fully dilated. So when you feel a contraction, you can go ahead and push.
Okay, I can push. Okay. I'm ready. Okay, I'm ready.
All right, we're going to hold your legs. Okay. Make it easier.
Push. Okay, I'm pushing. Ready? Push.
Okay.
Contraction, push, push.
That's good, good, good.
Doing great, Noelle. Bringing the head down nicely.
It's not every day you get to see a baby being born. Especially if it's a robot baby.
That's right.
A lot of pressure.
That's it, that's it. Okay.
Baby's almost out.
Is it a boy or a girl?
It's a baby girl.
It's a girl.
Noelle is a lifelike birthing simulation tool being used to train medical students around the country. And Johns Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore just got theirs.
And I have to tell you, everybody, that's all I wanted to play for you, that there's a robot now that gives birth for you, and this robot does not look real at all. It's a terrible representation of a human being. I don't even know why it's called a robot. Nothing moves. Like, I think the baby's just basically pushed out. Like, there could be someone at the end of the bed with a plunger in the middle of this little dummy pushing the baby out the vagina. But very unrealistic, silly robot. Congratulations to everybody for wasting media time on that, because it basically looks like a CPR dummy that we've all trained on, except it has all the appendages. Very interesting stuff. Anyway, I had to play that because I thought it was ridiculous, and I thought you might like it. There is one piece of news that I have to mention to you before this Nick Redfern excerpt, and I thought it was really cool because I'd never heard of this before. And I have to read you the article. It's just a short one. Excuse me. And it's about crop circles in the snow. And I've never seen anything like this before. Ever. Where are we there? I've got one of these windows with a million tabs in it. Here it is. This is great. Crop circles in the snow. And this, the crop circle in the snow, this is in the Alps, actually, just so you know. And the crop circle looks like a Mandelbrot set. It's huge. Like, it stretches over an entire range of mountain. Go to planetski.eu, planetski.eu, and /news/2527. And check this out. It says here, each winter they appear on the slopes of Les Arcs, intricate patterns in the snow that are best seen from afar. But what are they, and how do they get here? The photos are extraordinary. For several years, strange geometric patterns have appeared in the snow in Les Arcs, France. Quote, the largest patterns are the largest I've seen and are incredibly intricate, says Planet Ski reader Rob Rees. Quote, they really have to be seen to be believed. They appear when all the weather is fine and often during spells of prolonged good weather after a snowfall. And then, you know, basically it says, where do they come from? And the answer is, apparently, they're done by a British guy, Simon Beck, who lives in Les Arcs during the winter. He's a keen snowshoe walker, and we guessed he'd need to be to do this for a hobby. And he steps out these amazing patterns from time to time. If you know him, do ask him to contact these guys at planetski.eu, as everybody would love to hear about why and how he does it. And you look at these pictures, and there's some close-ups, and I don't think so, folks. I don't know. Check out the pictures for yourself. Very interesting. They could be like, it almost looks like, it definitely looks like a Mandelbrot set. Mathematical formula where, you know, everything in nature mimics itself from the microscopic to the macrocosmic. Or macroscopic. Or it could be, you know, some sort of connection of transistors, but it looks more like a Mandelbrot set. So check it out for yourself. Quickly now, I want to read this excerpt from the NASA Conspiracies by Nick Redfern. I mentioned it in the last show when my dad was on with me. That was really nice. Thanks, Dad. Mr. Bruce out there. I appreciate that. And to all company there who are or may be listening still to my rants here on the radio. The NASA Conspiracies, the truth behind the moon landing, censored photos, and the face on Mars. I wanted to read something from one of the later chapters in the book. And it goes something like this. I've saved until the very last what is quite possibly the absolute strangest and certainly the most controversial of all the stories that posit a link between NASA and unusual animalistic life forms. The story came from a man named Bruce Weaver, whose grandfather worked at Brooks Air Force Base, Texas, in a medical capacity in the early to mid-1960s. On November 21st, 1963, one day before President John F. Kennedy was assassinated in Dealey Plaza in Dallas, Texas, and 9 days after JFK had instructed NASA Director James Webb to try and develop a program with the former Soviet Union in joint space and lunar exploration, a highly significant event occurred at Brooks Air Force Base. On that day, President Kennedy dedicated 6 new aerospace medical research buildings at that location that were said to be vital to NASA's burgeoning manned space program. The dedication proved to be historic in the sense that it was Kennedy's last official action in his elected role as President of the United States of America. Interestingly, there have been rumors suggesting that JFK may possibly have been far more than just the latest results in aerospace medicine during his visit to Brooks, such as the biological remains of alien cadavers recovered from the UFO crash at Roswell, New Mexico in 1947. This story made it all the more intriguing by the fact that among those with whom JFK was arranged to meet at Brooks was Major General Theodore C. Bedwell, Jr., who from 46 to 47 served in the position of Deputy Surgeon in Chief, Industrial Medicine, Air Material Command at Wright Field, Ohio, the precise location to where it is alleged by many UFO investigators the bodies from Roswell were taking midway through 47 after the recovery from the harsh deserts of New Mexico. Now, just that little clip there of JFK being involved in the UFO phenomenon reminds me of Dark Skies that Bryce Sable just had re-released on DVD that everyone's so excited about. Anyway, on with the story here. Also during the visit,